We all know the big problem facing anybody wanting to build in Britain, and that is finding the land. And if you want to build next to the sea, well then plots are rarer than hen's teeth and go for top dollar. So the couple I'm going to meet this week, well they've addressed this challenge laterally, or I should say vertically. Instead of building their house on a virgin plot, they're going to build on top of another building.
James and Catherine Gray live in Bournemouth on the south coast. James runs his own book distribution business, and Catherine works for an investment bank. Right now, they live in an apartment on the second floor of this former Victorian hotel. 3 years ago, James also bought the top floor flat. It was originally built as a solarium for the hotel in the 1920s, for holidaymakers to soak up the sun. Now, James and Catherine plan to convert it into a modern luxury penthouse.
We're building right out the back here, an extension all the way across.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right.
So it literally comes out right the way above us. And
the view isn't exactly wonderful here, is it?
Well, I mean,
why are you building here?
You need to come round and then look behind you.
That's the reason
why. No. I see now why you want to do it. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
That really is.
Yeah. This is for us. I mean, on the south coast, there couldn't be anywhere really better. I love sailing, and this is some of the best sailing in England. So just living by the sea here in this spot is just perfect. Mm. I think the best is actually on the weekend mornings. You can sit there just looking out over the bay, having a cup of coffee, and it's just gorgeous.
It's like holiday. Sometimes we feel like holiday, so we don't have really the need during the summer months going away. We would be in a way silly not to do it, because we try to maximise this beautiful view we have to the sea.
How are you going to make sense of this place? Because you've got a big grey, what's that thing over there?
There's another water tank, right?
Right. And this, there's a stair tower by the looks of it?
This is another lift shaft here.
Right, okay, and there are chimneys, all kind of rubbish. How do you create your Eden out of this?
We can't remove these, the planners, and in fact these are serving water tanks to the building.
Yeah.
So it's a question really of just trying to blend them in with the new structure.
Yeah. And are you connecting it to that big dome?
Well, the dome's in the living room.
Right.
And it'll be roofed right the way across. So yes, all joined.
James and Catherine's large rooftop extension will almost double the size of the old solarium. They also plan to remodel the existing structure, which includes this unusual architectural gem.
This is the dome.
Lord! This is the dome.
Yep.
It's massive. It's twice the size inside than out.
Yeah,
why is that?
It's like a TARDIS.
What are you going to do with this? I mean, do you take the stud work down?
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to put a big curved beam about halfway around.
Yeah.
And then mezzanine that across there, and stairwell up the side, and a library up in the top.
Yeah. Really?
Yep.
Well, that's wonderful. What a fabulous idea. I mean, that's sort of Harry Potter-esque, isn't it? It's sort of phantasmagorical, that idea. You kind of put a library up in a dome, you know?
James and Catherine's grand design is essentially two projects that'll run together. The first will be a large rooftop extension, which will become the main living area of the new penthouse. This steel-framed structure will be cleverly inserted between all the obstructions on the roof and lead out onto a glamorous rooftop terrace which will have those coveted views along the coastline. Inside, through full-height sliding glass doors, the open-plan living, dining and kitchen area will be a light and spacious addition to the existing building. The second part of the project will be the remodeling of the old solarium, taking full advantage of the unusual octagonal living room that commands a view of the horizon. James and Catherine will remove the room's ceiling and reveal the dome above. James intends to kit it out as his private mezzanine library. There are two existing bedrooms and a bathroom to one side of the dome. On the other side, James and Katrin will knock together two rooms to form one big master bedroom with its own ensuite. When it's finished, the whole penthouse will exploit every view from its privileged position. The solarium cost around £300,000, and James has negotiated hard to get a fixed price deal of £200,000 for construction.
Were you just simply able to, with permission, build out onto that roof?
Except the permissions were twofold, weren't they? I mean, it was yes. It was the planning permission, and then obviously the permission from the block to do it too.
And all the inhabitants here of the block, they had to agree to it.
Right. So who's designed the building?
Well, the design has been very much us with the with the building engineer. Mm-hmm. So it's not a separate architect.
But what an architect can give you is that extra magic, you know. They can create space out of nowhere. They can also make sure everything's clean, flush, that it's all kind of beautifully resolved. So what guarantee do you have that working with just an engineer that you're going to get that kind of that aesthetic perfection, that clarity here?
It's a good point. I think we spent a lot of time with a lot of people, friends and people that we know, just coming in and asking people for ideas.
And then don't forget we're talking over 2 years now, yeah, which is a long time.
So the plans have evolved slowly over that period. But yes, no, I think we're pretty comfortable now that we've got the design that we're after.
Who's project managing it?
The building engineer will be the project manager. Yes. So he's put the whole thing out to tender and managed the whole process.
Right, okay. Yeah. And is he responsible for bringing it in on budget as well?
Yes, he is. Yeah. Absolutely.
So what's through here?
The builders provide a site manager. But Katrin is also taking time out from work at the bank for the whole build, not just to keep an eye on progress, but also to keep the peace with all those who live directly below.
But my biggest concern is really the noise and the neighbours. Oh, for us, it's a very serious issue. Yeah.
But everyone is aware and they know where the scaffolding is going to be, and so it's not going to be that intrusive.
Try telling them about that when it happens. Yeah. Try telling them.
That's the plan anyway, but I won't be here. So.
Do you work nearby or where?
Backwards and forwards, so I travel quite extensively.
So I get all the blame basically all the time.
Yeah. So you're asking quite a lot of Katrin, aren't you? I mean, she's going to have to run the project. She's going to be taking ownership. The build is going to be handed over to her, isn't it, at the end? Not to you.
No. I'm just a two-bit part at the end of it.
James's job takes him away for weeks at a time, leaving Katrin to keep the neighbours sweet as the builders cut open their roof to construct the penthouse. It'll be dusty and noisy, and they need to get all the work done over the short summer months, because if it rains, the chances are it'll be raining into the flats below.
The thing is, they've got to get so much right here. Look, they've got to hide all this crap on this roof. They've got to somehow mask those mediocre buildings in the background. They've got to stabilise this surface to build on top of it. Then they've got to bring up all the materials, four floors, up a hoist at the back. And underneath where they're working, they're going to have 35 separate households to placate. I think for Katrin, this is going to be 16 weeks of hell.
Above Bournemouth's sandy beaches, James and Katrin Gray are extending an old rooftop solarium into a large luxury penthouse. Building so high up is difficult enough, but there are also 35 neighbours to keep happy and dry. What's more, instead of employing an architect, James and Katrin are relying on their building surveyor, Rod Matheson, to deliver their dream. But in week one of the ambitious 16-week schedule, Rod comes across his first major problem. Some of the steelwork holding up the water tanks is badly corroded.
You can't really see from the outside just how bad it is, but if you come inside here, inside the tank room, and just look down, you can see the sunlight shining through the web of the steel. Now, the significance of all this is that this steel is not only taking the load of this masonry construction here, such as it is, but it's also taking the load from about 15 tonnes worth of tanks, water tanks, which serve the majority of this block. So if that steel was to fail, in theory, it could actually collapse right the way through the building.
Mm-hmm. James and Katrin have no choice but to replace the steel. The new one takes ages to arrive, and since building on a roof is never simple, it requires a crane and some serious manhandling to get it in.
Bring it forward in, Bob.
Katrin's tight 16-week schedule is already suffering.
It took 3.5 weeks to design and get steel, and it's such a long delay, really.
At least with the roof made safe, the builders can finally start work on the large extension that'll form the main living area of the penthouse. Good news for James and Katrin, but not for the neighbours living directly below.
How are you suffering with the works at the moment?
Dreadfully.
Well, how is your night? A little bang, 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 bang over your head incessantly.
They stomp right over my bedroom with the hobnail boots on.
And the curbing is going like that.
Well, I've had 3 light fittings coming down.
All the walls are cracked.
Oh. I know one day that they'd done something terrible. And I went into the hall and threw the window up and I said, "Be quiet up there." And no one heard, but I felt so much better.
Managing the neighbours and the build is a huge job. This was originally James's project, but his growing book business means he hasn't got the time to oversee it.
I'm away. Bye.
So, he's leaving it all to Katrin.
Well, it's now a very flaming June. Thanks to the water tank problem, this project is already 4 weeks overdue. But today is a very big day because they have wrapped the whole building in scaffolding and they are about to start craning up the steels that are going to form the cage of this penthouse.
The steel frame has been designed and manufactured off-site, so it should just bolt together. Building surveyor Rod Matheson, who's also designer and project manager here, has to work out how to fix the new steel frame to the old flats below.
What we've done here is we've cut holes into the roof, located the load-bearing walls underneath, built back up through the roof, and provided concrete pad stones, which then take the point loads from the corners of the frame.
And spread it through the rest of the building.
That's right.
So effectively, you can see the whole frame now is sort of flying, isn't it? It becomes suspended, floating above the old structure.
The air gap will provide a sound barrier between the penthouse and the flats below, ensuring that in the future, James and Katrin's neighbours will be happy. But Katrin is increasingly worried about the present.
So how does it feel like seeing the steel go in?
I'm very excited.
You seem a bit nervous.
Yeah, I'm nervous about the timeline, that we might run out of time. Yeah. And if you think about it, we're now at the almost middle of end of June, and we're having just 3 months left, and it seems to be an awful lot to do still for only 3 months, because I'm thinking October, November, we will definitely have more rain again. So I think that might be cause an issue for the project if you're not finished by then. The neighbors, I mean, it's just for the personal relationship, really. I mean, the noise is already a big issue.
Is it? You get lots of complaints?
Yes. So in case of the relationship going forward, it would be better for all of us if we really finish by September.
This project is already a month behind schedule, so it's a big relief to see the steel frame go up so quickly.
With conventional masonry buildings, it's quite hard to understand the shape of the building, or the form, the volume, until you're weeks into the build. But look at this, look. You know, steel is a fantastic material. It's very strong, it's rigid, it can span huge distances. But the one great advantage of it for a client is that in one day, with a skeleton like this, you can understand what a building's going to be.
With the steel frame for the extension knitted between all the obstacles on the roof, the builders crack on with finishing the floor and walls in timber. They also need to get a roof on the extension as quickly as possible. The builders have cut holes in the existing building to attach the new structure to it. So until the extension is watertight, the flats underneath won't be either.
Normally we'd have like a temporary roof over the whole build, which was down for, but it was a bit expensive.
But how much would that have cost?
I think it was approximately 30 grand or something like that, which is quite a considerable sum.
That is, isn't it?
Yeah.
Here, you're what? You're putting a new roof over the old roof?
I mean, at least then we can keep the old roof in as long as possible.
Yeah.
To protect the building underneath.
I mean, it's very, very tough, this, isn't it? Because you're stitching a new structure into an old one, but there are all these flats underneath.
Exactly.
Yeah, tricky.
Unwilling to pay for the temporary cover, James and Katrin gamble on the summer weather holding out. But of course, the inevitable happens.
It was coming through there, down onto the carpet, like a waterfall.
And all
really, down. Really. It was coming down like a fountain and it belongs into that house and there it went.
And it started in our flat. James tried to do as much as he could on Sunday and they've done what they can
yes,
on
Monday.
Yes,
but then James should have phoned the people to come and do it. If I had somebody doing work on my house and it went wrong, I would say, come back and put this, can you put this right? Because what does it look like? It looks like a slum, quite honestly. It was buckets and it came through there and thank God they put the lights on.
I'll bring you notice the mat underneath the mat, the boards are doing that now. They're all swollen, you'd bet.
With James away, Katrin is left to play the diplomat.
I mean, to be honest, I think it will calm down because at the moment, I mean, it's like, the heat of the moment,
yeah.
Basically, oh my God, you get water in. If I get water in my flat, which I had in the past, of course you're upset.
It's virtually impossible to do 100% tanking job on something that goes through the actual existing roof.
I mean, the issue is obviously at the end of September, we will have to live here. I want to have a good relationship with my neighbours. I want to be here the most hated woman in the flat, obviously.
Not protecting the roof was a poor decision, which has backfired spectacularly.
You're going to pay in terms of speed and delivery of this project, without a doubt, not having it entirely covered because it just makes it so much slower. And you're going to have to pay for redecoration of
apartments
and refurbishment and so on.
Yeah.
So you're going to have to pay anyway.
Yeah,
the question is whether or not you're going to pay. Is it still cheaper than putting a roof over the top?
It's still a lot cheaper, without a shadow of a doubt. Trust me on that one.
They'd have loved you to put a big structure over the top of it.
No, I'm not sure, because then, I mean, there would have been a whole range of different supports and everything else. I mean, it was quite complicated to do, so.
James and Katrin may have saved money, but it has cost them a lot of goodwill. Inside, work is progressing more smoothly on the amazing copper dome, which will become James's library. It's never been insulated before, and the awkward space needs a high-tech solution.
This is metallized insulation, developed by NASA. 14 layers of conventional fleece, which traps air, and this stuff, this sort of plastic foil, which reflects infrared radiation, heat, back into the room. This is only an inch thick, but it does the same job as that much polystyrene and that much fiberglass.
By midsummer, the extension is almost complete and the interior's taking shape. James is away again, so Katrin is taking more and more responsibility for the project and introducing her own ideas.
More we get involved now, more I think my creative side is coming out. For example, 2 weeks ago, I suddenly had the idea we could build a big aquarium in the wall between the hallway and the dome. And I think this would be an amazing feature.
Of course, Katrin's changes were never included in the £200,000 fixed price that James originally negotiated. So every alteration will add to the bill.
Yesterday I spoke to Rod and we came up with the idea that probably we might change now the kitchen into the position where the dining room is at the moment, and the dining room putting here in the corner to get a much bigger living room area.
The problem is that every change Katrin makes affects the schedule. It's a real headache for Rod.
We are catching up with the changes.
Ah, so it's all client-driven, this?
Well, there have been a number of changes. I mean, we know the kitchen position has moved. We've been wanting to get hold of those ultimate kitchen drawings so that we can then superimpose them on our own drawings. They have a relationship with the windows, with the roof lights and so on. And
how many more changes to the spec and the design do you anticipate from your clients?
There probably can't be many more, actually. Physically, I can't think there could be any more.
I can see why Katrin wants to make changes. She wasn't around when James was planning this project, so now she's putting her stamp on it.
So, whose project is this? Is it yours? Is it James? Is it your joint project? Whose idea was it?
I would say at the beginning, when James bought the place, it was definitely, I would say, his baby. I, at this time, was more keen on getting actually a house and a garden, but
yes.
Obviously James went ahead and bought the penthouse. Yeah.
Okay, what, sort of unilaterally?
Yeah.
How can you possibly have any sense of ownership? And do you feel connected to it at all?
Yeah, it grew on me, you know, it grew on me over the time. But I'm quite a flexible person. And I moved a lot.
You mean flexible in terms of accommodating?
You're
going to be okay about living here?
Yeah, I feel okay
about
it.
Do you feel excited by the project?
Of course, of course.
Back from his business trip, James discovers even plans for his dome library have been given the Katrin treatment.
So this has all changed, hasn't it? I mean, in as much as you were going to have a sort of crescent moon platform, mezzanine,
yep,
running across the side. Yeah.
She decided she didn't like that. With some reason, actually, because when you come in, you were just going to have a ceiling above you.
Mm.
So now instead, redesigned to have a balcony walkway all the way around.
And what about the staircase then that you were going to have here that sort of arrived?
Which was never I was never really that happy with it, and Katrin certainly wasn't because of the window there. So we're actually going to have a spiral staircase going up from here,
right,
up onto the platform, and then you can walk.
Neat, I like that. There. Very filmic, very, yeah, quite theatrical there. Having a library accessed by a spiral staircase.
Yep.
At the very beginning, this was James's dream. But now, Katrin's the one on site, and she's having to make major decisions for the both of them.
In fairness, because I haven't been around, much of the aesthetics really come down to Katrin, and I've been more concerned about pinning down the detail of what it will actually be on paper and the price. And I think that's the way we've kind of worked it. Mm-hmm. So Katrin's pulled together lots of different options, and generally speaking, we go with the aesthetic option, which, surprisingly enough,
I've noticed that Katrin can be quite forceful.
Yeah, well,
I know what I like and I know what I don't like. If you see the change, if you saw the changes on the plans, we had some major changes, really.
Yeah, that's down to you, isn't it?
On my designs.
I think J of the plan is post Katrin.
Absolutely.
And that's major. The kitchen's in a different place.
Yep, kitchen is. The whole design and the
whole dome
is all different.
The whole dome is different.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Yep, JKLMN.
When I first met James and Katrin, I could swear that they told me they'd spent 2 years planning for this project. Beats me though what they did for 2 years, because ever since she's been on site, Katrin's done nothing but make change after change. The plans they've got, I mean, well, they're not worth the paper they're printed on.
Katrin and James are 13 weeks into building their luxury penthouse overlooking Bournemouth's sandy beaches. They're a month behind schedule, and after flooding their neighbours once already, they're racing to get the penthouse roof watertight before autumn sets in. The final pieces of the jigsaw are the roof lights, which, like everything else on this build, have changed radically from the original design. Katrin has moved the kitchen, which has altered the position, size, and number of roof lights. And now James, who's back on site, has decided he wants them motorised. But the constantly changing plans have confused the builders.
I'm not sure where you got these internal dimensions from.
And the openings have been made the wrong size.
Whatever is the fair exit, A is the external weatherproofing, obviously. B is that it can't look like a balls up. And C is, in terms of how much it comes in, you need to think about the effect on what it looks like from down below.
I was expecting to come in and have the lights all fitted and everyone having a cup of tea. But unfortunately, that hasn't occurred. So they're hoping to be able to finish off the work and get them fitted tomorrow.
The following morning, the carpenters have had to come back to adjust the timber surrounds before the new roof lights finally go into position. Of course, more changes mean more money.
It must be around at least £15,000 just to spend on the three skylights. And personally, I think that's a lot of money to get skylights in. But obviously, we see the result, and I think it's definitely worth it to have them here. Because if not, I think it would have been a little bit too dark.
It's now August, and the builders are tackling another of Katrin's big alterations. They're putting the newly designed circular gantry into James's precious dome library. It's taken an extra month to draw up and order the curved steels, but now on site, they're laid out on the floor, ready to be fitted.
Basically, the centre of gravity is pretty difficult to find on something like this, so never tried it yet. It's going to be the first time, so here we go. It's a world's first. Work it.
James and Katrin watch as their magical library takes shape. But there's a problem. James isn't happy with the position of the staircase up to the gantry.
All I'm concerned about is the effect on that, because that has moved the stairwell to the right. If it's not centre to that wall, it's going to look funny.
The opening for the staircase is 3 inches out, and James isn't happy.
All I'm worried about is just taking 5 minutes out,
having
a real think, just making sure
how
we do it.
Yeah, no worries.
I just saw that, and I don't want you guys to end up having a fuck up. At the end of the day, if it's wrong, they'll have to undo it and do it again. Mm-hmm. It's just time and hassle.
What James wants is he wants it central to that because his TV's going there and he doesn't want the staircase intruding on his view of the telly. So I've got to do something.
The steel workers have to remeasure, recut, and rotate the whole frame by 3 inches.
I've moved all the frame a certain amount of degrees round. That's bang on the middle of the room then, within a couple of mil, I think. And if he complains about that, I shall sue him.
Visually, it looks fine.
It looks fine. Yeah. I think it looks fine.
But I like things to be precise.
James also likes to make a ton of decisions whenever he visits site, which Rod has to deal with along with Katrin's changes.
Just get the corners on.
There's now a fish tank, and the window spec has changed.
Because we need to decide, obviously, that we're going to use aluminium all the way through or UPVC all the way through.
All of which slows down Rod and his team.
Originally, we were going to have PVCU windows. That's now been changed to aluminium, pleased to say. And the only problem is that the order for those windows was placed literally just 3 weeks ago or so. And they are on something like a 7 or 8 week delivery. So we're due to have finished by late August. And the windows won't even be arriving, you know, until sometime after then.
It's now September. The build should have been finished a week ago, but the problems of combining new and old structures and the constant changes to the design have put the schedule at least 8 weeks behind. There's no choice but to throw more men at the job.
So how many blokes have you got on site at the moment?
Around 10 every day, between 8 and 10 men.
Yeah. Blimey. So they're really piling in, aren't they?
Piling in and also being under the pressure, obviously, to finish now as the deadline has been
This dome, you see, I'd have thought that it would have felt too low, but actually it feels rather spacious.
Yeah. I think actually it gets the best out of the room because when you even go up there, when you stand up there, you even realize how high this room is, and it even gives a different dimension, brings a different dimension to it.
Yeah.
So I think it's my favorite room. I think the room so far worked out really, really
well. That's good. But there are other changes, aren't there? I mean, yes, the staircase has changed
for
this.
Changed.
Skylights.
A skylight wasn't planned. There was a change.
Now there are three skylights.
Yes, three instead of two.
The two of them move.
Yes, they moved actually three times.
Three times.
To get a position
what
right.
else has changed? The portholes?
Yes, portholes, windows were not planned.
But all these changes.
Yeah.
They add more money, they add more time.
Yeah, but I think, I really truly, we both believe they're worth it. They're really worth it. Yeah.
Any other changes?
I mean, to be honest, I would love to do, I have so many more ideas now, but if I just mention to anyone.
A bit late.
James had negotiated a fixed price contract for this build, but that's been blown out of the water by all the changes to the design.
So in practice, day to day, I mean, how do you agree all these extras? Because you did have a very, very tightly worded, tightly sewn up contract, didn't you?
The whole thing was spec'd out, and all we do is if there is a change. For example, take this window behind you, that was a change. So we discussed with the window guy, right, what would be the cost of a new frame, putting some glass blocks in there, what's the cost of that? And depending on the scale of it, we'll either get a fixed price for that addition, or just say, right, we'll do it, and it's on. We've got an agreed schedule of day rates for the plumbing, for the electrician, for everything.
Right, so if they say, I don't know, it could be 2, 3, 4 days of work, you say, well, fine, just do it.
Yeah. Well, so it's quite easy to manage the process. Funnily enough, for me, everyone sort of said, well, if I'd have done this again, what would you do differently? I'd have definitely put more time into the design up front and thinking through the minutiae of the detail. But the reality is, a lot of things, until you see them, I've not done it before.
Do you know how much you're spending? How much the extra is all going to add up to?
I'd need to do a
you
couple
don't, of... You don't, do you?
I've got a... I have a ballpark figure.
Which is? Well, tell me now, and then I'll ask you again next week, and we'll find out how accurate your estimate was. What do you think it's
going to be? No, I'm not going to tell you that.
Oh, come on.
No.
£49,000.
No, nowhere near.
51.
Nowhere near.
53.
No, less. Way, way less.
Unfortunately, even Rod is losing track of the project.
Because of all these changes that have occurred, I don't feel I've got that same level of ownership as I would have hoped to have had at this stage. So it has been a real struggle to try and control the costs as such, and we've not been able to keep it within budget, which is, that's in that respect, is disappointing.
For Katrin, it's more important to make things as she wants them rather than stick to the budget or involve Rod. Now she wants to incorporate a coloured lighting system into the dome.
It's what's known as RGB, colour change, so there's red, green, blue. And clearly, when all three colours are on at the same time, that makes white.
You okay?
Yeah.
You ready, Martin?
I'm ready.
Okay.
See what you think of this
one. What do I think? I think of Amsterdam, I think of Hamburg, and of Bournemouth High Street.
Whenever you reach the colour that you like, you can stop it. So you're not stuck with any particular colour, so it's very versatile.
Great. I like the blue.
Lovely, isn't it?
I'm sure James will love it. James loves the blue light anyway.
Katrin is blithely happy to spend around £3,000 on the coloured lighting system alone.
I really think we need to get this room right. So in this case, I think we're happy to invest some money. And because saving on the lighting, I don't think it's a good thing. Because lighting is a very important part of a build like this.
Aside from adding all the coloured lighting, just plasterboarding the awkward shaped dome is proving tricky enough.
We're actually using our brains, Alan. It's amazing, isn't it?
It's awkward now.
I felt old, but...
bad idea.
Has it been lucky so far?
Perhaps it's skill, not luck. That looks all right, doesn't it?
Katrin and James are now several weeks beyond the original deadline, and there should be no more time for changes. But Katrin has one more surprise for me.
What's this?
Okay, basically,
somebody's put a big cardboard box here.
Kevin's our new study, the second study we are creating. Yeah.
What do you mean a second study? This is your bedroom in here.
Yes, but I never really felt comfortable with this large room here, and I think I'm probably a person who likes more kind of cozy bedroom.
I'm not convinced this is one of Katrin's better ideas.
God, this is tiny.
Yeah, but this is supposed to be a tiny little cozy study.
And it has sprung up from nowhere, just like that.
It wasn't really nowhere because I had this always in my mind.
It's just another change.
One of the few things that hasn't changed are the sliding glass doors that lead out onto the secret balcony and to the views over the coast.
How do you open them? Do you know?
Okay, I try now. So obviously we have to start here.
This is your door, as
that's
it were,
the door
one you use all the time?
All the time, exactly.
Okay. And it just keeps on going?
And it
brilliant.
Should keep on going like this.
On these runners, which I like those. Look at that. Admittedly, there's no glass in it yet, but that's next, isn't it?
Okay, perfect.
Wow. So the idea is that the floor in here will just run up and out at the same level.
And so we are all on one level, basically.
The windows are a real milestone. With the whole build watertight, work inside can surge on. The project, now in its eighth month, has taken twice as long as expected, but at least the end is in sight. While most of the neighbours haven't been too badly affected, those immediately below have had to endure the worst of the noise and dust.
The whole aspect of everything is purely inconsiderate and just doing what you want and not giving anyone else any regard.
Because it's caused a lot of people distressed as well as us. There's a lot of people much older than I am, 80s, and just round the corner, and they said, God help us, if we'd never known this was going to happen, we wouldn't have been here.
We wouldn't have come here.
I'm going to have to move now out of my home to have a bit of peace.
I tell you what, James is cunning as a wagon load of monkeys, because all he does is skip away after time, leaves poor Katrin to do
the job.
Having alienated those living underneath them so much, I wonder whether Katrin and James will ever be able to really enjoy living here. It's now February, 10 months after the builders started what should have been a four-month project. Outside, they're still not entirely finished. But James and Katrin are so desperate to move in, they've installed their furniture, and they're on the brink of enjoying the fruits of their labours.
Hello.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hello.
Good to see you. How are you?
Good to see you again. Hello.
And you.
Hi.
Do you know what? I just came through that. You arrive here in the lift, pull the door back, you look through the porthole, and it's weird, it's like going down, not up. You look through to the sea with these fish. It's quite an arrival, you know. It really is something, though. It's beautiful. How's this this room here?
Come and have a look. Come and have a look.
So, what do you think?
That's turned out rather noisy, isn't it? It's very crisp. It is very crisp indeed. It's very sharp, you know. Sure. I like this Art Deco balustrading you've got. Mm-hmm. You sort of put it in. The whole thing's got a very nautical Art Deco scene. Yeah. What I love is being able to stand here and see right out to the horizon. You know, an uninterrupted view across the sea.
It's gorgeous, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. No, but I just love it. I just love the atmosphere in here. It's very.
I think it's a nice mixture of sort of contemporary. It's very crisp and sharp.
Yeah.
And I think the key thing was
trying to get the right factor of the staircase balanced with the rest of the room. Mm. And I was pretty sceptical of having everything in. I thought it was going to be too busy, but...
Well, I was going to say, you know, you put a lot of stuff in, but there are no blank walls.
But it's still very spacious.
Yeah, no, the space is very it's very cleverly managed. It doesn't feel too low. I think there's a kind of nice connection to the dome, you know.
Plans for the mezzanine in the dome have changed several times, but are the changes for the better?
There's a lot more space than you think from when you're looking downstairs.
Mm. It's a proper room.
And the funny thing now is that we thought, oh yes, we use it now for the library and get all our books up here, but now more and more we think, oh, should we leave it a little bit more open, keep it as a kind of gallery almost?
Mm-hmm. I mean, we're still going to have bookshelves and books up here, but not have it quite so formal and keep a bit more space, keep it a bit more open.
Renovating the original architecture of the flat has been problematic. I think the dome is a reasonable success, but some of the other spaces, like the corridors and hallways, are awkward and the rooms feel boxy. I'm hoping that the new extension knitted between all the rooftop water tanks works a lot better. But with Katrin's record for making changes, I'm still not sure what I'll find.
Oh, this is all right.
This is now the kitchen.
Do you know, I was expecting something far worse than this.
What? Far worse?
Yeah, well, your description of it with about 26 different materials, I thought I was expecting to see some kind of really...
What do you mean, far worse?
Over the top. This is rather nice. I do like the little marshmallow lights at the bottom.
Yeah.
The key thing here was putting the kitchen in this snug in the corner here. Putting the dining table right by the window, swapping the two over.
It actually works very well.
Plus the kitchen is more the centre, the centre of the flat, which I think is a good position for a kitchen.
And the dining room area, whatever you want to call it, is bang in front of the picture window, which is fantastic. I mean, you just sit here and look out.
Yeah.
Don't you? I mean, that view is what it's all about, isn't it? I mean, I could sit here with that view eating beans on toast and you can dine like a king.
Yep.
I like the way you come out here and it's the same level. You
know? Yeah.
You don't have to step down or up. This is great, isn't it? The way you look out over those gardens to the beach and the view beyond. And it's a usable large space as well, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. It's, it's larger than we thought. And
not your garden that you wanted, though.
I know, I know, Kevin, but it's a nice compromise, you know.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Normally, of course, in people's gardens, you'd expect to hear the sound of traffic, cars pulling up. You don't hear any of that here. It's just the sound of the breaking waves.
It's beautiful, isn't it? Very restful and peaceful.
Yeah.
It really is.
James and Katrin weren't permitted to change much about the exterior of this place, but where they have managed to put in new large windows, they've taken full advantage of the rooftop position.
Well, isn't that fantastic? It must be wonderful to wake up.
Especially in the morning,
Can you see it from the bed?
Yeah, you can. I mean, please test it, Kevin.
I'll test it.
Test the view.
This has got to be worth it though, hasn't it? I mean, okay. The scaffolding's yet to come down.
Yeah,
but this has got to be worth it, hasn't it?
I mean, it's amazing. I mean, it's for me, it's really unique. It's a really unique place. And I mean, I just love it.
Other than the views, I think where this project really scores is in its quality. It's well crafted with some finely executed detailing. And it's high spec. The lighting alone is testament to the no-expense-spared approach lavished on the fixtures and fittings. But all this window dressing doesn't make up for the project's failings, not least the effect it's had on the angry neighbours immediately below.
So given this whole thing has been so disruptive for the neighbours here, it's been a bit of a nightmare for you, are you on reasonably good terms with the neighbours?
I think that there is a... The answer is yes. I mean, we're all talking and getting on. I mean, you know, everyone who's lived here has been living with builders, traipsing up and down, and that's not easy, but there was an expectation of that. It's just a shame it's dragged on for so long.
£30,000 would have given you a protective roof over the whole building. In retrospect, wouldn't it have been cheaper to do that than suffering these delays and extra costs?
No, because it wouldn't have done it. When the wind blows here, at 70 miles an hour off the sea, it's driving the rain horizontal, and you either have a proper, complete roof covering, or you're going to have water coming in. And there's just no way around it.
So have you had to do any remedial work to the flats downstairs? I mean, is that all done?
Oh, I mean, there's a fair chunk that has been done, but the remedial works need to get finished off and get tidied up and move forward.
Yeah, okay, so why did it go on so long?
Probably me in particular, questioning all the plans right at the beginning in April, May. I mean, if I would do it again, I would have more knowledge about it, being more realistic about timelines and the work, and I would do the planning much, much better.
You've certainly got quality of craftsmanship and quality of execution. I think it's contentious whether or not you've got real quality of design here, because I think there are bits that just do not work as well as they should. That room out there, the lobby, is not a room. It's a space into which other rooms kind of impinge. Yeah? And I think that if you'd employed an architect right at the top, you could have produced a building in which every room was beautiful, fully resolved, magical.
I think I have to take some of the responsibility there. It was me who had sort of tried to think, well, I would just do this and get it done cheaper and quicker. Having said that, there's no question that a lot more time and effort, it was the learning part, a lot more time and effort on up front on the design. Mm-hmm. And in fairness, Rod actually pushed for that, and I was pretty busy at the time.
No.
And well, I didn't even say no, I was just pretty busy, so.
It seems clear to me that what you're saying is that we need to do this again. You'd want to spend a lot of time up front with a designer or architect, kind of just talking through what is possible.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We missed that creative bit of flair that came in.
So is there then a bit of the building which you're particularly proud of?
I think I've got three favourite bits. Mm. I mean, the windows, I think, were a complete find. They were great, the folding doors.
In the dining room, yeah.
Yeah, and I just love the effect that they give when they're right open. It's just fantastic. But then the kitchen space.
I love the kitchen also. I think the kitchen and having the space going in there, I think is fantastic.
And then in here.
I love the aquarium. I love to come in here and look through the aquarium onto the sea and just having this view right from the beginning. I think is fantastic.
And how much have you spent, James?
More than I thought I was going
to. You were
going to
spend 200?
Well, it's more
than that. I cannot believe you spent 200. You must have spent nearer... Three or four.
I've spent more than I thought.
You're not going to tell me, are you? No, you just ain't going to tell me. Oh,
no.
Oh.
No. It was more than I thought it was going to be, but I think that every bit where we've spent more money, I'm pretty comfortable with. This is a unique space, and I think we'll be here for some period of time to come.
You know, this is a project which has been saved. Say partly by the quality of the craftsmanship here, but also partly, ironically, by the overrun, which allowed Katrin to go back and make all those design changes, many of which were improvements. But I think that with the help of a good architect, they could have done so much more here. You know, this is a good project, but it could have been a great project if only they had invested in some design right at the beginning. And they sort of learned that, you know. Katrin and James, I think, now know that good design isn't about shopping. It's not about spending money. It's about spending time.